teaching practice through the use of digital technologies. What an evangelist. Nelly, thank you for allowing me to be part of this. Really want to give a shout out to the folks at YZQ. I think it's just wonderful that we can use a system like this to connect globally. I see that we've got people from all over. And last but not least, I really want to thank the participants. Just like the airline, I know you had a choice. For some of you, it's early in the morning. Others, it's late in the day. For me, it's great. It's just 5 o'clock here in Calgary on a beautiful spring day. So what I'm hoping is, I'll be honest, you know, they say the more you know, the more you don't know. And part of the reason I was so excited to be part of this was to learn from you, because this is a really rich opportunity. We've got people from all over the globe. So I'll be honest, I've got some slides prepared, and I'm going to go through them. So just Nelly talked about this community thing, and I want to talk about it a little more because it is a Canadian thing, eh? So we'll do that. Oh, no sound. Okay, Susan, I hope you can get sound and come back. Just a little bit of studying. But since this is a day about blogging, about sort of intentionally reflecting about our learning, and I think we all know that Nelly has an amazing action research online course going on right now, I thought I'd try and kill two birds with one stone. I've got to be careful about saying that, because that's what my wife studies, is songbirds. But I thought we'd just sort of get a bit of a framework going here, and then we're going to do a lot of collaboration, a lot of crowdsourcing. Let's see if I can get to slide. Okay, so again, just I think it is important. There's a lot of really amazing frameworks out there, and I think it's becoming for us to understand that what is new is old. A lot of these things have, you know, been around for quite some time, and you know, I think we should really build on the shoulders of some amazing women and amazing men. So I live in the western part of Canada. It's Alberta. I'm going to be careful because I know we probably have some Americans, but we're a pretty right-wing place up here, sort of like Texas North. And we really, really seem to have an issue with this term, inquiry-based learning. Some people seem to love it. We've had huge parent protests against it. So what I would love, if you wouldn't mind, because sometimes I find we get mixed up with speakers, but we've got a wonderful chat room here. Could people just right off the top of your head, when you hear the term inquiry-based learning, for some of you it might be a buzzword. For some of you it might be jargon. For some of you, and I'll be honest, like me, it might have some real in meaning. It might even put a little glow on your face. So I'm just going to be quiet for a moment, and just in the chat room, it's in the bottom right-hand corner, it says write your message here. If you could just, you know, what's the first thing that comes to mind when you hear something about inquiry-based learning? So if you just type something in and send it, that'd be great. So we'll just wait for a minute. I see that Tosif has said yes, and Canada, right? So just wait for a moment. I know it's going to come in. I probably got this mixed up. Transferring. I know that people are typing. People are awake or sleeping. It's coming in. I know we're going to be typing. I'm going to say hello. What do you think about inquiry-based learning? Ah, here it comes. Super. So we've got people talking about the Socratic method. Super. Aloha. Susan, Hawaii. Oh, living the dream. The Socratic method, have to have some evidence and not just what they feel. I think that's important. You know, it's sort of evidence-based practice. It's not just perspectives and opinions. That's wonderful. Oh, Susan's great. Here from Hawaii. Difficult to tackle. It is. It really is a difficult thing. And I think the problem in our province in Canada is that we haven't had a really good conversation of inquiry-based learning, whether it's in K-12, post-secondary, or even in the workplace. So just moving on here a little bit, it's fascinating. I'm going to give the University of Calgary a little bit of credit. I mainly work at Mount Royal University, but I teach a number of online courses at the University of Calgary. And they did something really cool a couple years ago, is they hired an undergraduate student and a graduate student, and they just let them go. And they said, any student, any professor you can get a hold of, ask them, you know, what does inquiry-based learning mean to you? And, you know, sure enough, there was different disciplinary differences and stuff like that, but these were the five commonalities that kept coming over and over and over, that it's problem or it's question-driven. You know, this idea of curiosity-based learning is that it doesn't take place in isolation, it takes place with other people. And I'm going to be talking about this wonderful Canadian a little bit later on, Walter Archer, who's back at the University of Alberta. But in Canada, we have an issue. We call it pathological politeness. And it's this idea of critical discourse that we have to learn to agree to disagree with your perspectives, not you as a person, but again, you've got to be able to defend what you're up to. The idea that it takes place across disciplines, not just one area, and that it is. It's just not airy fairy. And in all our disciplines, there's a rich methodology. And I think for more and more of us, it's a mixed methodology between qualitative and quantitative methods. So just a little shout out to UNC. Now, if we go back in time a little bit, this isn't a new issue. This is something we've been wrestling with for a long time, and I'm going to talk a lot about the University of Chicago, a very fascinating university that some of you probably know was created by the Rockefeller family sort of in about 1890 and had some really, really fascinating faculty members. One of them was Joe Schwab, and this was during sort of the space race between the Russians and the Americans in the early 60s. And there was a huge move to standardized testing that still is true in the United States, and unfortunately it's true in Canada as well. But Joe said, hang on, wait a minute. Knowledge isn't about a bunch of random facts and isolated skills. It's about developing those habits of mind, what it means to live within a discipline, what it means to think, to problem solve, not just a series of random facts and things like that. And we go down back a little further in time and talk about some of Joe's buddies. A lot of us remember John Dewey's work, and again, John was one of the original faculty members at the University of Chicago. And this is what I really like about John. You know, there was a lot of experiential learning in 1938. He said, inquiry is a technology that creates knowledge. And if we look down to the States, to the Association of Educational Communication and Technology, EdTech is a heck of a lot more than tools. It's systems, it's processes, it's ways of habits of mind. So again, just a little shout out to John there. Back a little further into time is that John wrote a lot during the First World War and a lot during the Depression. And his big thing was democracy and education during the First World War. And he really emphasized this idea that the strength of a democracy rests on its public education system. And I'll be honest, I hate this quote. 1916, nothing's changed. If we teach today's students as we taught yesterday's, we rob them of tomorrow. Ugh, things have not changed. Let's move up in time a little bit. And I always have to give Matt credit, because we're going to talk a little bit about a community inquiry, but we have to remember the term came from Matt Littman. Matt's an amazing, just like Piaget, an amazing, amazing researcher with early childhood education. Matt spent a lot of time researching his own grandkids, early childhood education, and just, you know, again, they say everything we needed to know in life we learned in kindergarten. That innate sense of curiosity and how we learn through sharing, through shaping our ideas and conversations with others. So that was Matt's work. I still remember the first time I saw this diagram. It made me dizzy. No secret, Randy Garrison, who was my doctoral supervisor, who was Terry Anderson's supervisor, just loves Venn diagrams. And I remember the first time he was showing this to me, and it was just overwhelming. But I'm going to try and break it down a little for you. It's this idea that, you know, it takes a village to raise a child. It takes many hands to make the word work light. It's this idea that we're social, we're humans. You know, they talk about what is the most important thing in real estate? It's location, location, location. Okay, let's just back up. Education, what's the most important thing? Relationships, relationships, relationships. So again, it's this social presence, but again, it's a learning presence. It's just not a social networking present. The idea that there is going to be some sort of cognitive thinking. But this is the term that Terry came up with, and I think this is so important, this idea of teaching, not teacher presence. Again, the idea, I think it was Joubert, that French philosopher back in 1842, to teach is to learn twice, that we all have to share the responsibility. So it's teaching, not just teacher presence. And then out of that, and they swear, I remember talking to David Kolb, a lot of us, just a little bit of work that's being done by a wonderful woman, Madeleine Bafous. Madeleine's based in the most beautiful part of Canada, the Okanagan. She's doing her doctoral studies with Athabasca University right now and really doing a meta-analysis of the community inquiry. And it really is fascinating, you know. It sort of got established back in 2001. And if you look at a lot of us, and I'm one of those people, it's fascinating, is a lot of us have built our work, whether it's in online or blended learning, around the community of inquiry framework. Some of the others, there's Johnny's, John Biggs, his solo taxonomy, Mesro's transformative learning. But it's just amazing how, my gosh, it's like 12 years later, it's still taking off. So let's just, we'll get back to you folks in a minute. We're going to finish the theory. Oh, another diagram that makes me feel wild. Some of you are familiar with David Kolb's work, Kolb's experiential learning cycle, and this is Randy's practical inquiry model. Both David and Randy developed this in the 80s. They swear they did it separately, but they both really are scholars of Dewey's work, of Dewey's model of sort of action, reflection, model, and just the idea that, you know, it often starts with a good question, a triggering event, giving us a chance to explore both sides of the story, but then how important it is that we start testing out our ideas. We start to integrate into our present frameworks, we move it at others, and hopefully we learn, we move to some sort of resolution, or in a lot of cases, one question leads to another question. Okay, active learning, exactly. I'm just about ready to get back to you. So just my little shtick in life, probably like a lot of you, I primarily teach people to be teachers. And I teach at both the undergrad and the grad level. And the problem with our courses, and a lot of you have probably taken this course, I took a course in the 80s, and it was about using overhead projectors, it was about using blackboards, not the Blackboard Learning Management System, but how to use a blackboard effectively. So there's a pretty neat dude there, Chris Deed, and Chris, some of you may know him, he's one of those endowed professors at Harvard. But what I like about Chris, and I've had a chance to work with him a few times, is it's not about tips and tricks. What we should be doing in these courses is helping students learn how to use digital technologies to solve real-world problems and develop their critical thinking skills. So I took on Chris's task to redesign this course, and I just want to show you a little bit about what we did. So the first thing we did is we got rid of, you know, little tweet assignments and, you know, what's happening on Facebook and Scribs and all these new things, and we focused on a semester-long project. And what we did is we worked with mentor teachers, mainly K-6 teachers, about what's happening in your real life. What are the issues? What are the problems out there? And so what we did is the students working with their mentor teachers found out what the issues were, and we used this practical inquiry model as a form of almost action research to guide our work. So I promise we'll get back to what we're supposed to do doing in a second. So just slide 16, just always have to cover ourselves methodology. Again, just got to give Nellie credit. She's doing a great thing about action research. You know, got to give a shout out to Ernie Stringer. It looks like he just put up a new version of his action research. But the idea that, you know, we want to collect data from more than one source. So we had some amazing blogs, and we're going to talk a lot about blogs in a minute. We did some surveys and some focus groups. So again, how important it is to get young students of all ages blogging, that intentionality. I've got a nephew who's 5 years old, weekly video blog, so easy to do. What's his goals for this week? He has to watch the last week's video, and then he does another one. But it's so easy for young kids to create these videos and reflect. And again, that's often our first form of communication is oral, and how these videos are really helping with his own writing and reading. Okay, enough of that. Let's go back to you guys. So the guiding questions for this was, again, I have two boys, I love them, 21 and 19, but when I tell them something, it goes in one ear and it goes out the other. You know, back to John Dewey's work, the only way people are going to learn is to have an experience. You know, put them in the bath water and see what happens. So I figured if we want future teachers to have an inquiry-based approach to their teaching. They've got to learn firsthand, and they've got to identify what are some of the opportunities, but what are some of the challenges, and how do you think you can use this in your future practice? So here we go, finally. So the process, and this is where I'll get you to jump in a minute. So again, I think it's really important for us to remember is that, technology is nothing new. Some of you probably remember this picture. It was probably a street sign in Alexandria. This is the Rosetta Stone, for those of you in the UK, in the British Museum. And this is how we started to translate hieroglyphics. Technology, using a rock on a rock, and we could write. So the idea, that technology has been around for a while. These are tools and things that help us solve problems. They help us develop those problem-solving processes. So one of the most difficult things I have found with my students, and this is where I'm going to put you back in the chat room, is we think it's easy, but there's a really neat guy in the UK. His name's Mick Healy. He just recently retired. He works with Paul Ramsden, the Higher Education Academy, and he does a lot of work with action research and undergraduate research. And he says, this is the most important thing, is helping students select questions, problems that are really meaningful for them. Getting those really thick and juicy questions, not those thin black and white ones. So I'm curious, because all of you, you're in the workplace, you may be in teaching, whatever. If we want to use an inquiry-based approach to learning, how are you helping? How are we using? What are the strategies? What are the different ways that we can use technology to really help students identify and develop their questions? So I know if for some of you, again, it's late at night, it's early in the morning, but hopefully you can use the chat room and just type in an idea. Something that you've done, maybe you've done it in Nellie's action research class, but I think this is something that we just skim over too quickly, is that we really need to give students and people in the workplace time, support, and scaffolding to develop a meaningful question. From the little research I've done in inquiry-based learning, this is the most important phase. This is what's going to either make it or break it, is providing students with an opportunity to really develop questions that connect with them. It's meaningful. It's not just something they pick randomly out of their mind, but we're giving them opportunities. So I see people typing. This is wonderful. It's always so tough for me online, that pregnant pause, this idea of Donald Finkel, teaching with your mouth shut. I'm just one of those people, you wind up and I talk forever. So I see people typing, just curious, because this really, this is where the rubber hits the road. It is, how do we help students? If we want to take an inquiry-based approach to learning, we want to connect it, if you've got standardized curriculums and stuff, how do we help them do it? So just wait there for another moment. I know it's coming. I see other people typing. It's coming. It's coming. I see it. It's happening. It's almost hatching. People are typing. It's wonderful. It's coming. It's coming. I see it. I'm even going to put a smiley up just to make sure it's happening. There we are. I see people typing. Just remember, click the send button after you type so that we can see what you say. This is good. Yes, adult learners returning to school. It's important at all ages. It really is fascinating. Again, I think I have to wait a long time to be a grandfather, the way my two boys are growing. But I've got a sister quite a bit younger than me, so it's just fascinating working with a 5- and a 7-year-old. Just shut up, Uncle Normie. Shut up. I'm thinking, shut up, Uncle Normie. I'm transforming into a superhero. I just don't think we give kids enough credit for what they've already got going in their minds and how we can build on it. So just as you're typing, I think, again, what's old is new, but it was so fascinating, and I'm sure Nellie's doing this in the action research course, and again, bad student, I'm not keeping up with it, but this idea of concept mapping, for those of us who've taught K-12, we used to do it on whiteboards and blackboards, but, Google's got all these fancy add-ons. Instagrok is just amazing. The videos come up. There's Lino, which is like a little sticky. You can put the sticky notes up. Padlet's like at Kaggle. But the idea of getting people to map out their questions and starting to connect it with existing resources. So again, let's not forget concept mapping. And what's so exciting now is that we can do it collaboratively and share it digitally. And again, a shout out to people like Nelly, it's all open source. We don't have to make money. Okay. This is something that's frustrating for me. My apologies, I was out skiing today rather than listening to sessions. But we just assume that students know how to be reflective. I teach in an undergraduate program, and I'll be honest, even after 4 years, to develop that habit of mind to be a reflective practitioner and to move from just a surficial to sort of deep, you know, connecting, you know, the theory of practice, what they're learning in the classroom to what they're experiencing out with their mentor teacher. So getting students to blog as they move through an action research process. And the great thing about a blog, as we all know, it's public. It's their ideas are there, but they can share it with other collaborators and other people. So, you know, for a lot of my students, we assume, you know, it's that old Mark Prensky thing, digital immigrants, digital natives. Wrong, Mark. I find so many young students are so anxious. You know, they know how to click buttons, but they don't know how to use technology in any meaningful or educational deep way. Okay, next thing, back to you folks. So, you know, again, we really need to spend some time up front. Again, it's just like doing needs analysis or all that instructional design stuff that a lot of you probably know, but really setting the conditions to be successful. The next step I find, and this is again, I'll turn it over to you in the chat room, once students have developed their questions, how do we let them go? How do we, you know, guide them in a meaningful way? What are some strategies, some technologies? And again, the world is our oyster now. You know, students can be using something like YZQ to conduct interviews with people all over the world. It just blows my mind the way that young students are doing this. So I'll just see. It looks like we're a little quiet in the chat room. But I'll keep watching you guys. Don't feel nervous. Keep chatting away, putting the chat. But just with time, I'm going to put a few things up. So, amazing. You know, Google, it's Larry and Serge. They've got elementary age kids now just putting tons of money into all these little Google add-ons and stuff. So they purchased EasyBib. So again, it's wonderful that students can share their bibliographies with each other. And I'm sorry, Nelly and I both had to do it wasn't a silly dissertation, but Nelly, the worst thing I hated was that APA formatting. Hey, no worry about that. It's all automated for you. Do you want APA? Do you want MLA? You want Chicago? You do it. So we can really focus on sharing the resources and getting the information. All that nitpicky formatting is taking care of us. So again, not to give Google Docs too much of a plug, but that's a pretty amazing bibliography in it. The other thing with Google Docs is that students don't have to do this in isolation. The reason I brought this up is just show you the number of iterations that took place. So what I always like the students to do is, okay, once we've got the question, what's happening out there? You know, and again, it's more than 10 talks. What are the videos? What are the blog posting? What's going on? I want you to find 5 sources related to your project and working with a peer, or I try and connect them with an external expert, and you can see it. It's just amazing, the revision history. Again, I think the speaker unfortunately wasn't able to make it, but this idea of formative assessment, we learn through ongoing conversations. Just like all of us who've written silly books or papers, it's an ongoing process. We just don't put up our first thing. And this is, you know, the excitement about blog postings. We put up our ideas, and hopefully it's more than just an opinion. It's something that we've got some evidence behind it. But it's just wonderful the way that students can really shape their learning through these collaborative discussions. Next thing is, you know, it's pretty darn easy to put surveys together, and we did take the students through an ethics process. It's kind of neat in Canada. Our human ethics process is completely online, so you have to do an online tutorial. So it was great for an ed tech course. They had to see what's good or bad about an online tutorial. They got it. They can send this so easy out to friends. Away you go. you can collect data from all over. You know, you tweet it out. We had Ellen DeGeneres. I don't want to get into Ellen too much, but I'm sure Ellen doesn't handle her tweet handle, or Oprah, but they'll retweet your surveys. And some of the students have had thousands of responses for their surveys. So just, you know, just incredible the responses they get. And it's global response. I saw that Nelly tweeted out, you know, a lot of us are on Google+, Google Hangouts, but so easy for the students to do interviews, correct research. Nelly, I think you're still based in Toronto there. Gosh, you guys in Ontario, you guys rock. It's the Virtual Researcher on Call. This is created by a whole bunch of ministries and organizations in Ontario, but it's great. They've got people set up in the different ministry offices where you can connect with them, do a session, all kinds of stuff. So it's, and you can even request mentorship for your project. So wonderful stuff that way. Okay. So what we do, you know, we spend a fair bit of time up front really helping students develop questions that are meaningful. We often get stuck in the exploration stage. Students love to go on and search and search and search and search and get information. But I think this is where, you know, the rubber hits the road. Okay, team, enough data collection. We've got lots of stuff. Now let's try and make some sense of it. And so it's great. Nelly's got Google Forms. Thanks, Nelly. You keep posting. This is great. So it is so easy. So the first thing, again, most of us, you know, it's amazing. You see little kids doing this. It's so neat to see little kids, and I'll post up some amazing websites from little schools, K-4 schools, you know. Parents aren't reading newsletters. You put up all these static websites. But you start creating sort of a student TV station or something. So students broadcast, you know, little Johnny and Susie, it's their day to send out the announcements. They do a survey, you know, about playground equipment. They show what they're doing. You know, Google spreadsheets, this is sort of a Calgary thing. Sorry about this, but we're really big on those silly smart boards. Just if you don't know, it is a Calgary product. So again, spreadsheets for the initial quantitative analysis, but what the students really love, and I think most, sorry, you see my bias, is really to get at that qualitative data. And I know Nelly, I'm sure, is covering this in the action research, but we have all these amazing different word clouds. A lot of us are familiar with Wordle or Tagzedo, but it's a great way for the students to initially identify what are the key qualitative themes that are coming out of all this text-rich data they've collected, and then they can go in and fool around with stuff. So all kinds of really cool ways for students to analyze data. So just selfishly for me, I'm so excited that students are excited about analyzing data, because that used to be a real slog for some of us old guys doing masters and doctorates. Another thing, and I saw Nelly doing this right in the beginning of her action research course, what a powerful way for students to start to integrate. And again, it's like almost a form of blogging or storytelling. You know, there's a bunch more that I think Nelly had, MoveNote, Present Me, Slide Speech. There's all kinds of, you know, there's the old iMovie, and then you can flip, and even PowerPoint's got a converter in there. But I find this is so powerful for students because, you know, it's a great chance. It's a first thing for them to put their data together. Start putting some bullets together, that kind of stuff, but then starting to hear their voice. And then again, you can so easily post it to YouTube and starting discussions around your digital story. So again, the triggering event, I can't emphasize that enough about getting students to form really good questions. Exploration's never been a problem for me. Students just go crazy collecting data. This is the thing that I think has become a little more sexy, is that we don't have to kill ourselves analyzing our data. We've got all these really cool digital tools to do it and cool stories to tell as well. Okay, and this is the fun one, and I think we don't spend enough time. This is a problem. We always run out of time. The semester's over. Is that we really need to have strategies where students not only are resolving their problems, but they're sharing it. They're celebrating with the people they collected data or whatever. So again, put some ideas in. I know for a lot of you, it's getting late. It's getting tiring. I'm blabbering on. But here's a few things that we So the first thing is that it's out of Simon Fraser University, but anybody under the sun can start their own journal. So, you know, the students putting all this time into putting digital stories together, I were getting them, you know, to create manuscripts. And a couple of them said, you know, at my high school, we had a digital press. Let's create one. So it's open source software. Again, I'll put up the website after. I forget where it is, but it's out of Simon Fraser. And I forget what it's called, Open Press. And it's just a couple clicks and away you go. And so it's wonderful. The students, we've got sort of an editorial team of students. We've got not only student reviewers now, each student's required to have an external mentor. So that mentor is part of the peer review process. And I'll be honest, you know, the students love this because these are just undergrad students as future teachers, and they've got publications. We've got an ISSN number and everything. We're just living the dream. The next thing that I think is if you can create some area where students can celebrate work with the others. And I'll be honest, this picture just made my heart so dear. This is an undergraduate student here. This is Marcia, just an amazing student. This is her sister, who's involved in doctoral work in education at U of C with her mom, who is an education professor at U of C. So it was wonderful just celebrating the work as a family. You know, we did it with teams and everything like that. So again, I think we really need, you know, it is. It's hard work. You can do this virtual showcases, all kinds of stuff, but just how important it is we create opportunities not only for students to finish their work, but to celebrate it with other people. Okay, let's just keep it here. Okay, the other things that we've been trying to do is work with our local school boards. So, you know, it's the me to we. You've given a lot in terms of your mentorship. What can we give back to you? So we've got another silly thing. You know, we've got all these repositories, don't we? You know, but why don't we just keep it all in Google? This is one we call CORE. It's Collaborative Online Resource Environment. But it's a lockdown thing. You can Google CORE, you can get in there a bit. But what I thought, students are developing all these incredible inquiry-based projects for K-4. These are teacher candidates. Let's share it back with the school, with the board. So, you know, sharing a foundation, a legacy. We got to figure that one out a little better. Keep moving here. This is where I think it's so important, is we're so lucky that we've got so many local conferences. Again, it would be wonderful if we could do more virtually, and we're working on it, but there's a lot of free stuff happening right in Calgary, and I think it's important that we press the flesh. So this is an amazing project. This is a grade 5 student who this is my teacher candidate here, David. This is the principal, Leslie. These are two of the mentor teachers, you know, the old guy. Oh, look at the belly on the guy, the old guy. And this is the grade 5 student who was the lead of the presentation. And it was one of the most powerful presentations I've ever seen, because he was talking about how we're not teachers, we are his learning partners. We're just at a different part of the continuum. And this was a brilliant presentation. This kid's in grade 5, but it was demonstrating how through this inquiry-based learning project, it helped him develop his own learning framework that was built and combined on the frameworks of others, including Dewey. It was just one of those things that brings tears to your eyes. Okay, we're just about done, and we can open to questions. So just a few little, you know, us research types, we have to end with things. So just, I think this was so important because, again, I could have done lectures, I could have just sat there and blah, 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 talked about inquiry-based learning, but after these teacher candidates completing it, these are the things they said, is the most important thing was empowering us, helping us develop the self-confidence, that we have the self-confidence not only to ask good questions, but we now have the frame set, the mindset to solve them. This idea that it is, you know, we're empowered to learn and that we can actually construct our own knowledge, and that it's fun. It's discovery and it is exploration learning. A couple other things we found. Opportunities. So, again, I think this is what we always want to do, and it's so frustrating for all of us because I'm in, you name it, every classroom. I just started a new teacher candidate in kindergarten, so she had to spend the morning with a mentor teacher planning her inquiry project, so I had to spend a whole morning with kindergarten students, and I had to go to bed at like 5 o'clock that night. The energy, like the positive energy. These kids, they come to us internally motivated. They come to us self-directed. Our job is to stop. Our job is to create those liberating constraints, to create opportunities, because kids, in from my perspective, my experience, are naturally creative. How can we keep building that so that that motivation is continuous? It's not about getting silly marks so you can go to university and stuff like that. It's about your love for learning, that you feel empowered, you're confident, that you want to go deep. You don't want to do shallow. You really want to go deep on it, and that you're excited to learn with others all around the world, just like we're doing today, courtesy of Nelly. All right, a couple more slides, and then finally he'll be quiet. Where are we? Okay. Again, this doesn't come without challenges. Is, again, especially, I'll be honest, I'm going to be careful, but in Alberta, we have these things called diploma exams. Kids sit down for 90 minutes. And again, I'm ADD, my kids are ADD. Getting me to sit down for 90 minutes is tough. Kids sit down for 90 minutes, and I don't know if you still do them where you're from, but they're called multiple choice quizzes. You fill in a bubble. You have a pencil and you fill in a bubble. You do that for 90 minutes. That is worth 50% of your final grade. That's going to determine if you go to which community college, which university. It determines where you're going to go in life. And again, the dirty little secret, we have lots of dirty oil in Alberta. We have about an 18% participation rate in post-secondary. That's vocational training, colleges, university. The national average in Canada is about 24 or 25%. It's just incredible. I'm going to finish here, but it's tough. So what happens, my teacher candidates have mastered taking tests, because the only way they get into our program is on GPA, grade point average. No interviews, nothing about your passion for teaching, what you've done. It's all your grade point average. So for me, I'm not being too sarcastic, but it's 4 years of on learning that it's not about doing worksheets. It's not about teaching to the test. It is. Inquiry is time consuming. It's hard work, but you will do it if you are passionate about it. The idea that, we do need some liberating constraints, especially when we're scaffolding, it's the first time. And again, these aren't frustrations, these are learning moments, and students are so excited to show us new tools and how to do things. So I think we've got over that. Just two more slides. What the students told me is, here's some advice, is that they really need to get a big picture. And again, it's not copying what people have done in the past, but showing examples from what students have done around the world. Not just students in my course before, but what have kids done? And there's examples all over the place. And again, a shout out, Nelly, I'm going to work with you, but we can share examples that we've been learning with, so they really get the idea of where we're going, but how there are going to be steps. So we're not going to get overwhelmed, but we've got that big, big picture in mind. Okay, couple more here. The other thing they said, sigh, sorry Americans, that's the scaffolding around the last shuttle. Hopefully we'll get our act together and you can keep doing space travel and stuff. But again, the process needs to be scaffolded. We need a vision of where we're going, but we need milestones. We need that sense of success as we get there. Okay, we've accomplished this step. What did we learn? Let's reflect in our blog. Let's move on to step two, step three, step four, so that we feel a sense of progression and celebration together. Couple more. We all know this. This is Nelly, you are the master. Is that anything to do with technology is embedded. It's a need to know. We only use technology when we need it, and usually it's the student who finds it, not me. So each week, me demonstrating something they found that'll help them. So it's not learning, we're going to do Twitter. When do we need to use Twitter? We probably need to use Twitter in the exploration phase to get our survey, to get news out about our study. So we need how to tweet. Maybe we're collecting things. One student showed me, I know you guys all know what Storify, but a way, of sort of collecting and making sense out of tweets as well. So again, it's embedded. The technology isn't an add-on, not the forest for the trees. It's not we're going to learn 6 million technologies, but here's the process. And when we need tools, let's share our tool set and use the appropriate tool and let the student make the selection about what tool works best for her or him. this is something that's huge in Canada, and I'm really upset that you stepped down. We've got this silly thing, but it can be a good thing in Canada. It's called the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council. So for people like me and Nelly, oh, this is one of these hoops I have to go through. It causes money. And he just steps down, Chad Gadfield, an amazing historian from the University of Ottawa. He was the president, and what Chad started is this storyteller program. It's just finishing, but again, you know, undergraduate, graduate students, you've done your work, obviously, you know, you've put papers, but we want to hear your excitement. Please tell your story in 5 minutes, and you can Google this site, just at SHRC, Digital Storytelling Project, all kind of prizes, but it just, it's amazing because the students are really passionate and exciting, and it gives them new ways to communicate their learning. So again, wonderful to see digital story taking place even with our federal government here in Canada. Okay, over here. Last one. Oh, it is our last one. So just, I'm going to put up the, I'll just do this last slide because it's more important than questions. But again, we've just got a few minutes left. It's been a long day. I'll turn it over to Nelly because we can either ask questions in the chat box or I'll turn the mic over to Nelly and she can moderate it because some people may want to say something. But I really hope, again, Nelly's done just an amazing job of this. This is one of the things I really emphasize with both my graduate and undergraduate students, is about creating our own professional learning networks, our professional learning communities. And I know Nelly's got to have the biggest Rolodex in the world, but you know, who can we call on? Who can help us? Because again, sorry to go over and over it, I said it at the beginning, it takes a village to raise a child. It takes many hands to get the work done. And again, when we think about the C word, it's got to be collaboration. It can't be competition. I think we've all given up on the digital tool gold mine or whatever. So with that, I'll be quiet. I'm going to turn it back to Nelly. If you've got questions, feel free to use the text box, or Nelly can maybe moderate a discussion. But again, just a huge shout out. It's been amazing. You know, what a day. Nelly, I hope you're able to do it again next year. You just, the time, the thought, the effort, you've put it together. It's been amazing. You know, all these sessions are going to be archived from all over the world. I think these are going to be amazing resources that not only we can use, but we can use with our students, with our network. So, Nelly, I'm going to be quiet and turn it over to you.